Now let's turn toward the derivation of demand and how we can get that from all the stuff that came before. Now first, let's build a value scale for something like the uses of socks. So here we're just going to come up with, say, 5. So first, if I have a pair of socks, sensibly I might want to wear one pair. Second thing I could do is maybe wash a pair of socks. Third, maybe I could make sock puppets. That's always fun. I could provide a chew toy for a pet, like so take up those socks, tie them together, hand them to my dog to chew on. Or finally, using them for dust cloths. That's another possibility that I could do with a pair of socks. Now here I want to pull in these ideas what we call the marginal use and marginal utility. Marginal use is really just the lowest valued fulfilled use. That is, it's the one that's on the margin. So if a use gets cut off, the marginal use is the one that gets cut off. So for example, suppose that I have 3 pairs of socks. Now sensibly, based on my value scale, which we saw previously, I'm going to first wear a pair of socks, second I'm going to throw a couple in the wash and wash them, and third I'm going to make sock puppets with another pair. So those are the 3 things that I'm going to do. Now of those, the lowest valued one is making sock puppets. So if something were to happen, say I lose a pair of socks, perhaps in the dryer, right, then I'm going to take the pair that I was using for sock puppets and I'm going to throw them in the wash and start washing them. Right, so that is the use. The sock puppets are the use that I will give up. It's on the margin. If a use gets cut off, it's going to be that marginal use. Now, marginal utility is a term that we use just for the value of whatever the marginal use happens to be. So how valuable is making sock puppets to me? Now, this isn't something where we necessarily have to give a number. Simply a rank is enough. After all, if we're just choosing between things, having some kind of numerical index is not necessarily particularly useful. Now, we put our goods toward the most valued uses first. This is very sensible. So if I only have 1 pair of socks, I'm going to wear them. If I have 2, I'm going to wear 1 pair, I'm going to wash a second pair. Right, so the most valuable uses get fulfilled first, check them off, then I can move down the list. Now that's going to imply then what we call the law of diminishing marginal utility. That is, the more we have a good, the lower the value of the marginal use is going to be. If I only have 1 unit of a good, it's going to go toward the most valuable thing I can do with that good. If I have 2 units, then first I do the most valuable thing, second I do the second most valuable thing. So now the marginal use is a little bit less valuable than it was before. Now it's not because the value of the marginal use changed, it's because the marginal use itself changed. If I have just 1 pair of socks, the marginal use is wearing them. If I have 2 pairs of socks, the marginal use is washing a pair of socks. So we end up with the law of diminishing marginal utility, that is, the value of the marginal use falls the more of the good we have. Now we can take these idea of value scales and combine them in order to get individual demand. Now we'll get there in just a few steps. First, we know that we have a value scale for pairs of socks. Right, so here what I've done, I've thought about that value scale for uses of socks, having various uses. Now from that we can derive a value scale for pairs of socks. That is, the first pair is going to be preferable to the second pair because the first pair fulfills a more important use. The second pair is preferable to the third pair because the second pair provides the second most important use, and on down we go. This also reflects diminishing marginal utility. That is, each additional unit of a good, the second pair, say, is worth less than the first pair because it has a diminished marginal utility, or a lower value than the first pair would. Then we can think about a value scale for different sums of money. Now, sensibly, I'd rather have more money than less. So let's say we have a list of, say, 6 different amounts of money. I'd rather have $10 than $9, $9 than $8, $7 than $6, and so on. Now the question is, am I ever asked to choose between socks and money? Well, it shouldn't take a lot of reflection for us to realize that, yes, we are in fact asked to choose this virtually all the time. Anytime you go into a store where they have socks available, they're actually asking you, would you rather have the money that's in your pocket, or would you rather have these socks? And so we are actually choosing between socks and money quite a bit. Therefore, if we're going to compare them, they have to be on some kind of value scale that has both socks and money on it, so I can figure out how I would choose between them. So here I'm going to intersperse them into a value scale including both socks and money. Now here, how we intersperse them, the only rule we have to follow is that a larger sum of money must be above a smaller sum of money, and the first pair of socks must be above the second pair, must be above the third pair, and so on. Otherwise, however I intersperse them is really up to me. So for me, I think I'm going to say I'd rather have $10 than even my first pair of socks. But the first pair comes as a close second. Then below the first pair is $9. Below that would be the second pair of socks, say. Below the second pair of socks, let's say it's $8 is just below that. Let's say $7 is below that, but I'd still rather have $7 than even my third pair of socks. The third pair of socks is just below that, then my fourth pair, then my sixth pair, and then $6, then my fifth pair, then finally $5. So here I've just taken these two value scales, I've interspersed them in a way where we always have a greater sum of money above a smaller sum, and where an earlier pair of socks, first compared to second, for example, is always above a later pair of socks. Yeah. Once you follow these two rules, you can put this value scale any way you like. And it's from this value scale that we can get demand. After all, demand really just tells us how much of a good we're willing to buy at various prices. But the value scale tells us the choices that we make between different goods on the value scale, remembering that we always trade up. So, in this case, if the price is $10, I'm being asked, am I willing to give up $10 to get a pair of socks? Well, according to my value scale, $10 is more valuable to me than even the first pair of socks. As a result, I'm not going to buy any at all. On the other hand, if the price is $9, the first pair of socks is more important to me than $9, so I am willing to buy that first pair of socks. So at a price of $10, my quantity demanded is zero, I'm not willing to buy any at $10, while at $9, I'm willing to buy that first pair. Now, a way to think of this is that the price is really kind of a hurdle that pairs of socks have to jump over for me to be willing to buy them. Right? So if the price is $10, the hurdle is so high that no pair of socks manages to jump over it in terms of its value. Whereas if the hurdle is just a bit lower, say $9, the first pair of socks manages to jump over. If the hurdle is a bit lower, let's say $8, well, I'll leave it to you to figure out how many pairs of socks will be demanded there. So take a few minutes, try to figure out what the rest of this individual's demand curve will look like for $8, $7, $6, and $5. How many pairs of socks are they going to buy at each of them? I'll give you a few seconds to do that. Pause the video and work that problem. Now let's take a look at the answers. What you should have ended up with was something like this. At $10, we knew that none was demanded. At $9, one was demanded. At $8, it should be two. Once again, think of the hurdle. $8, imagine we draw a hurdle on top of that $8. And we can immediately see the first and second pair managed to hop over that hurdle. So two pair will be demanded. $7, once again, the first and second pair make it over. So still two demanded. At $6, four pairs of socks manage to hop over, so four will be demanded. While at $5, even that fifth pair is going to be demanded as well. So, what point we want to make here is first, that the value scale, that is our comparison between sums of money and the value of various units of a good, provides us with the individual demand curve. Another important point is that the individual demand curve here follows the law of demand. At high prices, we don't want very much of the good. At lower prices, we do want more of the good. Now, when we look at the value scale, that gives us some reason why. That is, the price of the good is, in a sense, a hurdle that we have to hop over for us to be willing to buy the good. That is, the value of the good must, in a sense, hop over the price in order for us to be willing to buy it. The higher the price is, the harder it is for units of a good to hop over that hurdle and end up purchased. Now, when getting from individual to market demand, it's actually not that difficult. So suppose we have here two people. We have Adam, who is just like we described in the previous slide, and then we have somebody else named Belle. Belle happens to really like socks, but really only has a use for four of them. So for Belle, at $10, she's still willing to buy one pair of socks. $9, two. $8, will be willing to buy three pairs of socks. At $7 or less, Belle would buy exactly four pairs of socks. Now the question is, how do we get the quantity demanded by the entire market if, say, the market is composed of just Adam and Belle? Well, here it's actually not that difficult. You're probably already thinking of it. If at a price of $10, Adam wants none and Belle wants one, then naturally the market as a whole is demanding one. If the price is $9 and Adam wants one, Belle wants two, quantity demanded by the market is three. So all we're really doing is taking the two quantities demanded, that is, the 0 and the 1, the 1 and the 2 and the 3, adding them up, and that gives us the quantity demanded on the market. Now naturally here, a market composed of just two buyers is a very small market. We could think of this in much larger terms, but really adding this up to, say, the millions of people that are buying socks here in the United States would take a lot of time and would really not necessarily be any more instructive than the small example. Really, all we're doing is adding up individual demands for millions of people, just as we did here for two people, Adam and Bell. So, the quantity demanded on the market is really just what we call the horizontal summation of the individual demand curves. The reason we call it that is because, if we remember the demand curve, we have price on the vertical axis, quantity on the horizontal axis. Since what we're doing here is adding up the quantities demanded by various people, we're adding the horizontal axis, right? Or we're doing horizontal addition for the demand curves. Now, wrapping things up, from this video, we should get a few points. First is that the action axiom implies choice and preference. Second is that preference implies diminishing marginal utility. If we take diminishing marginal utility and combine that with the fact that more money is preferred to less money, we end up with the law of demand. And the market demand curve is really just the horizontal summation of individual demand curves. Put another way, group action is really just a composite of individual actions.